This is Paul McGuire, and you're listening to the Paul McGuire Report. The world is coming to an end. People have been saying that for centuries, and for centuries, that has not come true. They said it 1,000 years ago. They said it in the last 50 years, countless times. Bible prophecy teachers, best-selling authors, have said that the world is coming to an end, Christ is returning, and time after time, it proved not to be the case. When the French general, Napoleon, rose to power in Europe around the time of the French Revolution, his dictatorial power caused certain scholars of Bible prophecy to speculate, was Napoleon Bonaparte, the great French general, was he the Antichrist? And numerous other names of high-profile politicians, even in our days, people have wondered, are they the Antichrist? And we've heard time after time that this is the time of the end. Christ is returning on such and such a date. In fact, during the year 2012, there were tremendous amounts of information released through New Age teachers, people from different religions, Bible prophecy teachers, and authors all saying that 2012 was going to be the end of the world. And they were referencing non-biblical sources like the Mayan calendar and other New Age style interpretations. So when I ask that question, I am certainly not setting a date. The Bible warns us not to set dates. Jesus Christ said, no man knows the day nor the hour of the Lord's return. So we can speculate, we can have educated guesses based on our knowledge of Bible prophecy and current events, but nobody knows the date for sure. And so we need to refrain from making predictions that only end up being an embarrassment to God and efforts towards evangelism. There's been a number of books, and one particular author, you know, 88 Reasons Why Christ Will Return in 1988. And he wrote about three or four of those books predicting each time that in that year Christ was returning. He sold millions and millions of copies of his books. And then last we heard, I don't know if he's still alive, he bought himself an expensive cabin and was hiding out in the woods. But he owned a radio network, so he returned to his radio network and was still proclaiming this message, causing many people to stumble. There have been entire denominations and religious movements that have predicted the return of Jesus Christ. The Seventh-day Adventists made numerous predictions, and a group called the Millerites went up into the hills and mountains in the United States to await the second coming of Jesus Christ. And in each case, it proved not to be true. So this is not in any way to be construed as Paul McGuire's prediction as to when Christ is returning or to give any official time designation to the end of the world, which the Bible, again, very clearly warns us against. But it's obvious from studying Bible prophecy that the general signs of the times are being fulfilled and that we're in the general time period of the return of the Lord. Now, some people may disagree with me, but I believe, for example, that Christ could literally return tomorrow. But I also believe he could return 100 years from now. And some people say, well, Paul, there's no way it could be, the return of the Lord could be delayed that long, another 100 years or more. Well, I think it could be, because only God knows what's going to happen in our world, and only God knows his timetable. So we need to be careful. Now, another thing we need to be careful about is not becoming so fatalistic, so escapist, and by the way, I'm not accusing those that believe that the Lord will deliver them from the time of trial on the earth. that's not being escapist. That's people looking forward to God's supernatural deliverance. Other people are looking forward to God's supernatural deliverance in terms of being here, but delivered in the midst of God's tribulation period. I don't want to get into the theological arguments right now, although it's certainly a very valid topic, and I do have a position on it, which I've written several books on and published many articles on, because in addition to my activities as the senior pastor of Paradise Mountain Church, my activities as an evangelist and a Bible prophecy teacher, and somebody who uses media, television, radio, and books to reach people with the message of Christ through Bible prophecy. I'm also a professor of eschatology, or Bible prophecy, at a major Christian seminary and college where I teach or have taught Bible prophecy. And in the course of those courses that I taught, I would spend a great deal of time talking about different viewpoints regarding the rapture of the church, and would assign my students the responsibility of reading entire books on either the post-tribulation rapture or the pre-tribulation rapture or the mid-tribulation rapture and other points of view. My purpose, at least for this program, is not to get into the timing of the rapture. Again, a very worthy subject. But my purpose is to recognize that we are in the last days. There's no question about that. We were in the last days since the time of the Apostle Paul and the birth of the church on the day of Pentecost. But the signs of the times that Christ talked about in Matthew 24:25 have intensified greatly. And then God's prophetic super sign, which has only occurred in our general time period, when the Jews miraculously returned to Israel in 1948 after over 2,000 years of dispersion. And remember, Christ told his disciples with the temple of Jerusalem behind them, and at that time the temple was built by or enlarged by King Herod, and Christ prophesied that it would be destroyed and the Jews would be dispersed into all the nations of the earth. But there are numerous prophecies about the rebuilding of the temple and the return of the Jews to their land after a period of dispersion. So after 2,000 years of being dispersed as slaves or persecuted and to the four corners of the earth, in 1948, miraculously, the Jews returned to Palestine, as it was called, and reformed the modern nation of Israel. And that is a miraculous event heavily prophesied in the Old Testament and the New Testament. And that 1948 return of the Jews to Israel began God's prophetic time clock. It caused it to start ticking in a manner that alerts us to the fact that the situation with the Jews is a central, if not the central, theme in Bible prophecy here on earth. And so that has never occurred before, except in our general lifetime period. And by general lifetime period, I'm saying, let's say, in a period of around the last 75 years or so. Because Bible prophecy scholars and teachers were teaching, there was a time when Bible prophecy was heavily taught, especially with the early church. You read the epistles and you read the book of Revelation, and you see how many times in the early church and the Apostle Paul and Peter and the other disciples are making references to the return of Jesus Christ, to the end of the age, to the new world, not the new world order, the new world that Christ will bring when he returns, the new heaven, the new earth, and the new Jerusalem. And the early church was expecting Christ to return in their lifetime. And they carried this with them as they spread revival, and they literally rocked the Roman Empire with the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and revival spread all over the world. But then, when Constantine, who was a Roman emperor, he saw that the Christian revival and the teachings of Jesus Christ were spreading so powerfully throughout the Roman Empire that the revival that the Christians were spreading would lead to the destruction of an intact Roman Empire. And so the Roman Empire, prior to this Christian revival and Christian evangelism by the early disciples, was composed of people that believed in the gods of Babylon and the gods of ancient Rome. And it was very much a Babylonian religion. And they worshiped Babylonian and Roman gods and pagan gods. And so Constantine, being a master politician, realized that the only way he could keep the Roman Empire together was to play both sides of the fence. So he had to appease all the millions of people who had converted to Jesus Christ, and at the same time, appease all those that were worshiping the gods of Rome and the Babylonian gods. So what he did was, is he mixed the two religions and doctrines together. He mixed them together, he blended them, and this began the decline and began to erode the power of revival, because the church was compromised and the truth of the Bible was compromised as Constantine blended the Babylonian occult religions with the teachings of Jesus Christ. And so what happened was that Rome became the Holy Roman Empire. It became a spiritual as well as a political empire. And eventually the Catholic Church was birthed from this Holy Roman Empire. And the Vatican and the entire Vatican Church structure, known as the Holy Roman Empire, and the Vatican emerged as a consolidation of political power, spiritual power, and the Vatican merged the teachings of Jesus Christ with many of the Babylonian occult religious teachings, symbols, and so on and so forth. That's why you have so much disagreement today, and for valid reasons, as to when the Sabbath is and to why Easter should not be celebrated, because Easter, after all, is really a Babylonian occult holiday that revolves around the fertility god whose name is Ishtar, from which we get the word Easter. And Ishtar comes from Isis, and not the terrorist group, but the Isis who was originally named Semiramis, who was the harlot wife of the founder of Babylon, Nimrod. And so Ishtar and the fertility rites, because the entire Babylonian religion, occult religion, which officially began at ancient Babylon with the Tower of Babel, was an occult religion, but it was a very sexualized occult religion. And Semiramis, who historical legends say was either the madam of a whorehouse, or she was a prostitute herself, or a harlot. Some people say she was both a harlot and prostitute and madam, and in an incestuous manner. She was a very attractive woman, but was the mother of Nimrod. But because of her beauty, he married her anyway. But she was a seductress. She was very sexually immoral, and her name is synonymous with sexual immorality. And when she murdered her husband, Nimrod, she did it, according to the historical records and legends and the writings of ancient historians, she did it by cutting off the male sexual organ of her husband, Nimrod, and killed him and then told the people of Babylon that he had risen to become the sun god, Ra. And then it was discovered that she was pregnant, but she had a problem because how is it that she could become pregnant with her husband being dead? So again, she concocted a story, and she said that she used a phallic symbol. And I don't want to go into the specifics, but I think we're all adults and we understand what a phallic symbol is. And she used this handheld phallic symbol upon herself, and then she claimed to supernaturally impregnate herself, which caused her son, Tammuz, to be born through a supernatural impregnation using a phallic symbol. And so the phallic symbol became a central design, a piece of architecture and symbol in the ancient Babylonian occult religions. And the phallic symbol is also represented in architecture, both in the Vatican and Washington, D.C., and other places. And it's large, tall, phallic-like monuments, like the Washington Monument in Washington, D.C. is a phallic symbol. There's a similar monument in the Vatican in Rome, which is a phallic symbol. And the Washington Capitol is a womb-like structure. So you have the phallic symbol and the womb-like structure, the Washington Capitol. And then you see similar structures in a mirror city in the Vatican. They have the phallic-like structure and then the womb-like structure building. So this is a recurrent theme throughout history. And they changed the names of the gods many times. I mean, Nimrod's name, which became Ra, also became Osiris, it became Apollyon, it became Zeus, it became Jupiter, it became Prometheus, and many other names. And Semiramis's name, the goddess, she's the mother goddess religion, her name became Isis and Ishtar and Venus and Aphrodite and Diana and many other names. And she's also known as the Queen of Heaven. So the Catholic Church borrowed from many of these Babylonian religions. This entire mother goddess concept, which came from Semiramis giving birth supernaturally through supernatural impregnation via a phallic symbol. She gave birth to her son Tammuz. She claimed supernaturally. Of course, this is a counterfeit of the virgin birth of Jesus Christ from Mary. But the Catholic Church borrowed many of these Babylonian components. So when we talk about Easter, which is a celebration of Ishtar based on Isis, the fertility god, and the rabbits represent symbols of fertility. The eggs represent symbols of fertility. And there's far more and reproduction and the cycles of nature and the earth. So there's far more to Easter than just, you know, Easter egg hunt. And then when you look at the Catholic Church and you see the overemphasis, I believe, on Mary, the actual worship of Mary and her son, Jesus Christ, it's kind of a replica of Semiramis and her son Tammuz, which is a counterfeit of the Virgin Mary and Jesus Christ. So the Roman Catholic Church, the Holy Roman Empire, has all kinds of Babylonian symbols, the purple robes, the gold, and many of the ceremonies are Babylonian in nature. So that's where we stand. This stopped the revival that the disciples and the first century church ignited in Rome, and it watered down the gospel. And one of the primary doctrines and teachings that was removed from the evangelistic revival that was sweeping Rome was the removal of all the teaching on Bible prophecy. All the teachings on prophecy in the Bible were removed by the Catholic Church, most of them. All the teachings on Bible prophecy, the in-depth teachings on the book of Revelation, the entire purpose and plan for the Jews, which is a central theme of Bible prophecy, was removed by the Catholic Church. And then you had the beginnings of what is called replacement theology, where the Catholic Church began to teach the era that has been also embraced by 75% of the evangelical churches, that the Christian Church has replaced Israel as the people of God. And that is a very serious theological error. And along with that error, they say, well, because the Jews sinned and because they rejected Christ as their Messiah, they have forfeited their right to the land of Israel. And that right to the land is to be given to the Church of Jesus Christ. The Church of Jesus Christ has replaced Israel. But that's impossible, because when you read the Abrahamic covenant that God made with Abraham and his descendants, God made an everlasting covenant and the physical descendants of Abraham, that they were to be given the land of Israel as an everlasting covenant, which simply means that they have a covenantal promise from God that the descendants of Abraham, the physical descendants of Abraham, have a legal right to the land of Israel because it was given to them by God and it can never be taken away. That's what the word everlasting means. It means it's without end. So the Jews can't sin and lose their right to Israel any more than Christians who are truly born again. If they sin, they don't lose their salvation. So it was these eras come out of the Catholic Church. They've been adopted by evangelicals, because many of the reformers who were the heads of the Reformation, like Martin Luther, retained his anti-Semitic beliefs, which he received from the Catholic Church, and he believed that the Church replaced Israel. But the Bible doesn't teach that. And the final proof text that the Bible doesn't teach that is the fact that when Christ returns at his second coming, he returns specifically to Israel and to Jerusalem, which proves that God is not finished with the Jews and the nation of Israel. And we read similar passages like Zechariah chapter 12 to 14. We read about how all Israel will recognize during the tribulation period that they rejected Jesus Christ, and their eyes will be supernaturally opened by God, and they will begin to weep and mourn for him like one who weeps and mourns over their long-lost son. They will have a supernatural recognition that Jesus Christ indeed was their Messiah, is their Messiah. They'll repent of the sin of rejecting him, and there will be a great revival in national Israel as they receive, once again, Jesus Christ as their Messiah, or receive him perhaps for the first time as their Messiah. And it says that the unclean spirit will leave Israel. So the Jews are destined by God to return to Christ as their Messiah at the end of the tribulation period, which is also known as the time of Jacob's trouble. So in fact, the entire calendar of Bible prophecy is built around the Jews and their return to the land. And so the 70 weeks of Daniel, which is a prophetic revelation given to the prophet Daniel, not only shows us the four great Gentile world empires that were to arise after Babylon, and then the final world Gentile empire is the revived Roman Empire, which will be very similar to the original Roman Empire, and it will be Babylonian in nature, as the first Roman Empire was, and the revived Roman Empire will constitute a one-world government, one-world religion, and one-world economic system. And Daniel has a prophetic revelation of this timetable, but he also has a prophetic revelation regarding the coming of the Antichrist, the coming of Jesus Christ, and the fact that Christ will announce that he is the Messiah, riding a donkey through the streets of Jerusalem. That's all outlined in specific years known as the 70 weeks of Daniel, but it revolves, what God is doing, revolves around the interaction between God and Jesus Christ and the nation of Israel. So it's not an accident, for example, that the Antichrist, who is the head of this one-world government, most likely leading it from the center of the revived Roman Empire, and that revived Roman Empire may also pull in America, Canada, and some other nations. And the revived Roman Empire, headed up politically by, and the one-world government headed up by the Antichrist, and then the one-world economic system headed up spiritually with a one-world religion and a one-world economic system intertwined by the false prophet, who heads up both the one-world economic system and the one-world religion in the last days. So these are the central components of Bible prophecy, and as we look at them properly, we recognize that we're plunging deeper and deeper into the territory of Bible prophecy being fulfilled, because we read the historical reports, we read the economic reports from the international bankers about their plan to have a global financial reboot, move us into a cashless society, utilize Mark of the Beast technology. This was discussed heavily at the Bilderberg Group meetings. And the occult spirituality that goes along with it, the Illuminati symbols and other things, all of us indicating that we are in the territory of the last days. So what is the response of individual Christians and the church? And what is the response of people who are agnostics and atheists and non-believers? What is the response of people that currently belong to other religions? In light of all the fulfilled prophecies happening in our lifetime, and in light of the fact that we can see on the horizon more and more of these prophecies are being fulfilled, what is the appropriate response among all individuals in light of Bible prophecy being fulfilled? Well, what the responsibility is that every person is being presented with evidence and documentation and facts by God, in order that every individual is being given an opportunity to make a decision. And the question that the true God, the biblical God, the infinite personal living God of the universe, as revealed in the Bible, the decision that he is requiring every man and woman alive to make, is he is giving them a choice. He's giving them the choice to accept the true God, who is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me." And receive Christ's free offer of salvation by faith, by believing in Jesus Christ, and by repenting of their sins, and then by faith receiving forgiveness of your sins, inviting Christ into your life, and asking Jesus to make you born again, so that you have forgiveness of sins by faith, so that you're born again by faith, and then as a new creature in Christ, because you've been born again by the Spirit of God, you are guaranteed by Almighty God eternal life. You are guaranteed entrance into heaven, and you become a child of God and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. And Jesus is your Savior. And you will live eternally in a perfect body, in a new heaven, a new earth, and a new Jerusalem. And even if you die, that won't be the end, because you will be resurrected from the dead when Christ returns. And if you're alive when he returns, you will receive eternal life. So if you die before the return of the Lord, you are promised to be resurrected from the dead, even if your body is burnt up or it was drowned somewhere in the middle of the ocean. Your body will be miraculously reassembled, and you will be resurrected as Christ was. Christ was crucified on a cross, died. He was buried in a tomb where a giant rock stone blocked the doorway, and the tomb was surrounded by most powerful number of Roman soldiers who would be the equivalent of Navy SEALs, highly trained Roman soldiers. So there was no way that the followers of Jesus Christ could secretly sneak out the body. They could not get past the highly trained Roman soldiers that were in charge of guarding the tomb. But miraculously, the stone which blocked the doorway of the tomb was moved. And when they looked inside the tomb, they saw nothing but the burial cloths of Jesus Christ and saw angels, because Christ had resurrected from the dead. And nobody, by the way, has ever resurrected from the dead in human history, apart from a few places where God, he translated Enoch. Christ commanded Lazarus to come back from the dead. So we have those examples, but nobody has been resurrected from the dead like Christ was. So all the other spiritual teachers, all the other prophets, all the other so-called gods, all the other heads of all the world's religions, no matter how giant these world's religions are, the huge difference between Jesus Christ and the head of every other religion on planet Earth, the major difference is only Christ that resurrected from the dead. And that was prophesied that would happen. And so every follower of his who places their faith in Jesus Christ also resurrects from the dead. So the purpose of the time period that we live in is to give people an opportunity to be saved, to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. This is why God's intent, which is based on love, is summed up in John 3:16, where it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever should believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life." So it's the desire of God, because he loves everyone, that they should not perish. It's the desire of God that nobody goes to hell. And it's the desire of God that all men and women would put their faith in Jesus Christ, be born again, and have everlasting life. I mean, that's why God went to the enormous trouble and difficulty of sending his only begotten Son to the earth to be murdered by sinful mankind, to be crucified by mankind, to be the Lamb of God and take all of our punishment upon himself as the Lamb of God. He took our sins upon himself, and he took the penalty of our sins upon himself, so that God's righteousness and God's law could be fulfilled. And if we put our faith in that, then we can be born again and spend all eternity with God in heaven. That's a beautiful promise, and reveals the character of God, which is his enormous love for every man and woman alive. Again, it's not God's will that any man or woman should perish. It's his will that every man and woman would have everlasting life. Now, as we read about Bible prophecy, as we learn about Bible prophecy, we have to understand that underneath all Bible prophecy is this primary message that God is love, and everything he does and every sign he shows and everything he allows comes out of the fact that God is love and he doesn't want anybody to perish. It's it's because of love that he allows so many things so that people would turn to him. And that's the message of God's love and the message of God's salvation. That is the primary mission statement of Paul McGuire Ministries and Paradise Mountain Church. That's our primary duty before God, is to win souls for Jesus Christ. And God has led us to use Bible prophecy as a means of evangelizing people, as a means of winning souls. And that's why we have this radio program, the Paul McGuire Report, and that's why I write the books that I write, and I hold the local church meetings that I do at Paradise Mountain Church, and that we I speak at conferences and I do interviews. The goal is to use current events and analyze current events through the lens of Bible prophecy so that we can win people to Jesus Christ, we can disciple them, we can teach them how to occupy until he comes. And that's what this ministry is all about, and that's what I'm all about. That's what I've been called supernaturally by God to do. And every single one of us have been called by God supernaturally to do something. The Lord, who exists outside of space and time, which is a fancy way of saying he lives outside of the dimension of time, he lives in eternity. So he can see the future before it happens. And so God knew us before the foundation of the world to be here for such a time as this. God knew us before the foundation of the world. That means he knew who you are and I am. And he pre-planned for you and I to be here in this time period with this unique set of challenges as well as opportunities to be here for such a time as this. And we've all been given a mission and multiple missions by God to accomplish. Now, what is the purpose of Bible prophecy? Well, Bible prophecy is God's way, because God loves mankind. I can't underscore this enough. So many people, you know, when they read the book of Revelation, they read it from just a two-dimensional perspective, and they forget that behind all the judgments of God and the wrath of God and all the horrific things that are happening on planet Earth, they forget that God is love. Now, superficially, you'd say, well, how could God be love and allow this to happen? Well, what it comes down to is God is love, but he's also holy and righteous. And therefore, because he's holy and righteous, he can't violate his own laws. Because if he violated his own laws, he would cease to be God. Perfect and all. Perfect, you know, perfectly righteous, holy, and the agape love of Jesus Christ. So the only way he could make a way for man to have, and women, to have their sins forgiven was for him to send his son Jesus Christ as a sacrificial lamb to take all of our sins upon himself. Now, what the tribulation period is about and why God allows it to happen is because you have to look at it in a proper perspective. Every man or woman on planet Earth who is born and refuses to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior is going to stand before the great white throne of judgment. Their name is not written in the book of life because they refused God's free offer of salvation in Jesus Christ. And when they stand before the great white throne of judgment, they're going to be sentenced eternally into what I call a great cosmic prison called hell. And it's a place of eternal torment where the false prophet, the Antichrist, and Satan, fallen angels, and all those who accepted the mark of the beast will reside forever and ever. Conversely, all people who have accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, they will not stand before the great white throne of judgment. They will stand before the judgment seat of Christ, but that's entirely different. You're still guaranteed entrance into heaven by faith, but at the judgment seat of Christ before you go into eternity with God. The judgment seat of Christ is like an evaluation, more intense than that, where you're rewarded for all the things that you did, that you truly did for God out of a pure heart, and all the stuff that you did for your ego and yourself or whatever will be burnt up as wood, hay, and stubble. And it's going to be an intense, evangelicals don't like to teach on this, and it doesn't diminish the fact that we're saved by grace, not of works, lest any man should boast. But the stuff that we did out of self-centeredness, let's say we won souls, but our real motive was not a passion for the lost. Our real motive was to become an important person. So that's a carnal motivation. So when we stand before the judgment seat of Christ, God's going to reveal to us what our real motive was. It wasn't pure. And that will be burnt up by God, the fires of God's holiness. Now, if our entire life was, we're genuinely saved, but our entire life was built on self-centered motives and impure reasons, I'm paraphrasing, but we will be like a man or woman who's in a house that's completely being burnt down, but we ourselves will escape. And that's a very intense description, but it's the description of any man or any woman who's truly saved, but insists upon living life basically to satisfy themselves, even though they may appear externally to be doing things by God. How many times have you heard this? I hear this all the time. I have heard this since I was first saved. Oh, I pray that God, you know, will allow me to make a lot of money or succeed, you know, really big time in a particular career and make a ton of money and have fame and stuff. And then they say, so that I can give to the gospel, so I can finance the gospel, the preaching of the gospel, so I can finance ministries, so I can, you know, help the poor and needy, etc., etc. Well, it doesn't happen all the time, but what happens a lot of the time is that God actually blesses many of these individuals, because they say to God, they make a pledge to God, and God says, okay, you've promised to finance the gospel and finance ministries. Okay, so I'm going to supernaturally bless your business or your whatever you're doing, and they make millions and millions of dollars or whatever, or just a lot of money. Maybe it's just hundreds of thousands of dollars extra above and beyond, you know, what their obligations are. So what happens is they may give, but they give a very limited amount, or they don't give at all, or they just give a basic tithe, and they don't even really care, and they don't even give that out of a pure motive. They give that to be looked upon favorably, or to get themselves power in some church. You know, they get to be the elder and control the church if they write out a check. So their motives are impure. And the bottom line is, God did bless them supernaturally, but they didn't keep their part of the bargain. They didn't truly take their money and finance the gospel. They didn't truly take ministry of stewardship seriously, and they didn't truly pray about what they would do with their money in light of what they promised God. And so they're saved, but they weren't faithful, because God blessed them with an unusual amount of money, but they didn't use it in the way that they told God they would use it. And so they'll stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and they'll be saved, and whatever they did out of a pure heart, they'll be rewarded for. But if God gave them extra amounts of money and they didn't keep their word and finance the gospel and finance ministries preaching the gospel or give it in the areas that God was telling them to, their works will be burnt up like wood, hay, and stubble, and it'll be painful. Now, they still get into heaven, but they miss the reward they were supposed to get because they cheated God. A lot of people cheat God. Well, you'd be surprised. A lot of people cheat God because they bargain with God, and God keeps his promise, but they don't keep theirs. And so a lot of people are going to be saved, but it's going to be a rude awakening, and the selfishness will be burned up like wood, hay, and stubble, but they'll make it through like a person rescued from a burning house, and they'll get into heaven. But that's not what God wants. See, what God wants at the judgment seat of Christ is for every one of you listening, me included, to receive the rewards and actual crowns that he is giving out. Not for the purpose of an ego trip, so he can look into your eyes when you get into heaven and say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And so, depending upon what you are faithful in, many things or little things or whatever, wherever you're faithful, God wants to reward you at the judgment seat of Christ. And these rewards, by the way, carry on into eternity. You see, we all don't get into heaven, and we're not all given the same level of responsibility in heaven. What we did faithfully on earth, we carry with us into heaven. So in heaven, those that were faithful are going to be entrusted with a lot more power and beauty and responsibility from God that's all joyous. Because they were faithful down here on earth. You see, their faithfulness down here on earth, it got carried with them into heaven. The stuff that they did for self-centeredness gets burned up. It doesn't get carried into heaven because it's worthless. So that's important for people to understand. The person who lived totally for self and still is saved, do you think when they get into heaven that God's going to give them the same rewards that he gave the person who was faithful in so many areas? No, God is fair. And so what we do down here on earth, we carry with us into heaven. And that's why it's so important that we try to evaluate our lives in the light of the Holy Spirit and that we repent of sin down here on earth. And so God wants to use each one of us. He has a mission for each one of us. That's the thing. And the question is, God will speak to us about our mission. He'll speak to us through other people, parents, teachers, co-workers, peers, and people will talk to us about our talents and abilities, even though we may not recognize that we have them. And then God will also speak to us, and God has no problem communicating to us. The problem is we don't always listen, about what our mission is down here on earth. And to the degree that we faithfully carry out the mission is to the degree that we're rewarded. Now, in my book, A Prophecy of the Future of America, 2016-2017, the brand new book, along with the four DVD set that goes with it, also called A Prophecy of the Future of America, 2016-2017, the Lord put it on my heart to talk a lot about the economic system, to expose it. Because, as the Lord impressed upon my heart, you cannot understand Bible prophecy unless you understand the money system. The money system and Bible prophecy are directly connected. Nobody who claims to teach and understand Bible prophecy can really grasp what Bible prophecy is trying to reveal unless they understand the money system. So in A Prophecy of the Future of America 2016-2017, I explain Bible prophecy and I explain the money system. But I don't stop there. A great deal of the book is devoted to supernaturally equipping God's people to be able to prosper, accumulate wealth, accomplish their missions that God has given them, to understand that God is their source, capital S, and to show you how you can supernaturally prosper in good times and bad times, like the Pilgrims and Puritans did. In addition, how important it is that you get the wisdom of God, that you understand what it really means when God says that He gives us the power to get wealth. That's supernatural power. Money is spiritual. Now, I want to emphasize here that this teaching is not prosperity gospel teaching. This is not health and wealth gospel teaching. This is not heretical teaching. This is solid, biblically balanced, biblically based teaching on how God is our source and how God will supply our needs according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus, so that we can do what God has called us to do, and so that we can provide for ourselves, our loved ones, our family, finance ministries. And God doesn't want us to suffer in horrible and cruel poverty. God wants to supernaturally bless His people. So, in the book, I explain how that's possible, and I study intensively the lives of people like Joseph, Daniel, King Solomon, who was the wealthiest ruler and probably individual in the history of the world, and he was the wisest man in the history of the world. And in today's dollars, King Solomon, before he backslid, because he did backslide, and there's a lesson in that also, he disobeyed God, and that's why he backslid in his latter years. But King Solomon was so wealthy that in today's wealth, he probably was worth $500 to $600 trillion. Now, that is a great deal of money. But as I also explain in the book, because I talk a lot about money and power in the book, and individuals who have money and power, who use it for godly reasons and for evil reasons, the people that Forbes magazine lists as their list of wealthiest people in the world, that's a false list. Like Bill Gates is considered the wealthiest man in the world, according to Forbes magazine. And there's a bunch of other high-tech company guys that are very wealthy. And Bill Gates' wealth, I believe, is an estimated $50 billion. I have it in my book. But you see, that's not really, Bill Gates is not the wealthiest man in the world. There are international banking families that have been around for hundreds of years. They are the wealthiest people in the world, but it's hard to track their wealth because it's diversified under different names and corporate entities and foundations, etc. But many people estimate, let's say, in comparison, the Rothschild family, and they're a big Illuminati family, the Rothschild family is worth somewhere between, and it's hard to really get accurate numbers, somewhere between $150 trillion to perhaps $350 trillion. Well, you can see that that is way above and beyond what Bill Gates has. And there are other international banking families whose fortunes are in excess of $25 trillion and above. These are the super powerful elite. But you see, they don't have their money listed because they could write out a check from their private checking account and pay off the U.S. national debt. So I talk about the fact that the satanic world system is based on lies, and that includes the monetary system. I expose the fact that the monetary system is based on a satanic principle because the world system, which is Babylon, is based on a satanic principle. And the satanic principle is to enslave mankind, which I call the Pharaoh God King system. And the way the Illuminati and the satanic elite enslave mankind is through a multiplicity of means, but one is through the money system. And the money system is a debt slavery system. The name of the game is to get individuals and nations in debt, and the borrower is slave to the lender, the Bible says, and that way you enslave them. And when by enslaving them, you get total control over them. So we have to understand that the monetary system is occultic in nature. It's based completely on lies and sorcery. This is not just, you know, me spouting off from nowhere, because the Federal Reserve, for example, prints money from nothing, but loans the money from nothing. Wouldn't you like to be able to do that, print money from nothing, and then loans it to nations and individuals and makes interest on it? And this is also done by the central bank. So that's it's a system of lies, but it's a system that uses debt to make people slaves. And God does not want his people part of the debt slavery system. So, in the book, A Prophecy of the Future of America, 2016-2017, in the DVD set, I talk about thinking too, how people are programmed to think from childhood. And the Illuminati or the elite literally programs the masses to have a slave mentality. And so there's an artificial ceiling on how deeply, how high they can think about something, and that makes them slaves. And that's programming. The communist Chinese do that to their population, and they run into a huge problem. In fact, communist Russia and communist China have major problems in relationship to the way they think. Their people, they have a lot of money, have a lot of power. China is going to have the number one economy in the world and the number one military. But their people are not inventing the technology and the sciences, and their people are not demonstrating the entrepreneurial abilities that Americans have. You look at America, and it's one, you know, high-tech company after another, or it's a biotech company, or America is just bursting with entrepreneurs and new technologies and new sciences and new types of businesses like Amazon or PayPal or whatever. It's just endless in America. And it has to do with the mentality of Americans, even though the educational system is trying to program them out of program that American way of thinking out of them. The reality is that this powerful method of thinking came from the biblical worldview that previous generations used to hold. And even though they're trying to eradicate it through programming in the educational system, they haven't been able to completely remove it. So this American, you know, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, believe for the impossible, you know, can-do attitude, and it releases power and it releases people's abilities. Well, you see, in China and Russia, they're taught to be compliant when they're young kids. They're taught to obey the state, never question. Just obey and never question and be compliant and do what the Communist Party tells you to do and never think outside the box. Now, that's great for running a totalitarian dictatorship, as I explain with scientific studies in my book, A Prophecy of the Future of America, 2016-2017. But the problem is, and the communist government of China has recognized this, that their people that are compliant and can't think out of the box, they're crippled intellectually. They're unable to develop new companies. They're unable to develop entrepreneurial skills. They're unable to develop and discover new technologies and sciences, because the way that the Communist Party of China has programmed them to think. So I quote in my book, A Prophecy, The Future of America, which you need to read because you need to set your mind free from this kind of programming, because it's going on in the U.S. right now. And you want to make sure that your children don't succumb to this kind of compliant mind control programming. So you need to read the book and really understand it. Because if you allow your child to be programmed, that's what they want to do. Make your child a compliant world citizen who doesn't question. Just be part of the team. Just be a consensus builder. Be part of the collective. Be part of groupthink. And don't be an independent entrepreneur who creates and discovers things and builds companies and makes things happen. Don't be like that. That's what they did in China. So in this article that I quote, called, quote, Why China Can't Innovate, in the Harvard Business Review, the authors of this article give a detailed explanation while China cannot compete with America because of the way they've programmed their children. And so now they're trying to retrain their children and other totalitarian governments like Russia and other places. They're desperately trying to retrain their citizens and their children and young adults not to be a nation of compliant robots, not to be a nation of of non-independent thinkers, but to be inventors, risk takers, entrepreneurs. And that's what America used to do. Now America is doing it in the Chinese model, and it's disastrous. So how you think, having a biblical worldview, is essential to producing and succeeding and being an overcomer. Now, it's also critical to increasing and protecting your wealth, which I have a chapter on. But ultimately, God has a mission for you to accomplish. So I have chapters on the law of miraculous supply, an expose on the reality of selling your soul to Satan, because there's many people, many entrepreneurs, who actually sell their souls to Satan, and they prosper. Now, that's succumbing to demonic power. But, you know, God rewards those that diligently seek Him. You can prosper. You don't have to sell your soul to Satan to prosper. And then I talk about your mission. I have a chapter called Mission Possible. And I talk about the fact that every man and woman alive has a mission from God. And that mission is possible for you to accomplish if you will rely on the power of God and the wisdom of God and God's supernatural provision. And if people would meditate in the Word of God and really get into it and stop being religious and stop thinking in the box. Remember, there's a reason why America, and I go into this in detail into the book, America is the source, because of God, of so many scientific inventions. I mean, you could write 50 pages of all the scientific inventions and technologies that uniquely came out of America. The personal computer, the cell phone, the television, the radio, the phonograph record, the CD, the DVD, the air conditioner, the refrigerator, the motion picture projector. And we could go on and on and on. It never ends. The automobile. Oh, yeah, other countries had some developments, inventions, but nothing in comparison to America. And America had the most prosperous middle class in the history of mankind. The middle class really didn't exist in most of human history. It was either the super wealthy elite and the slave class. And that's what they're trying to do right now. The elite in America and around the world in the Illuminati are trying to redistribute the wealth of the middle class and create just two classes. The ruling class, the scientific dictatorship, the oligarchy, the technocratic elite, the 1%, if you will, and the slave class. And that's not what God intends for His people. God did not intend for His people to be slaves. But the only way you can circumvent that is through God's supernatural wisdom and God's supernatural blessing. That's what the Pilgrims and Puritans discovered when they entered into a covenant with God based on the covenant that the children of Israel made with God through Moses in Deuteronomy 28, where it lists the blessings and curses that would be poured out on the people, and that were contingent on two things. One, they had to worship the true God as the only God. They could have no idols. They could not worship pagan gods. They had to worship the true God. Number two, they had to diligently hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. That means they had to diligently understand and obey God's word. And if they did that, then there's this detailed list of comprehensive blessings that are economic in nature and cover every area of life that God promises to pour out on his people. And then midway through chapter 28 of the blessings and curses, then there's the list of curses that are poured out. And they're very detailed and they're economic and they cover all areas of life. And the curses are then released if God's people worship false gods or if they violate or disobey the word of God. Now, the pilgrims and Puritans entered into a covenant with God based on the covenant that God made with Moses and the children of Israel in Deuteronomy 28. And that is the primary reason that America prospered. It's the primary reason that our government came up with the totally unique document of the Bill of Rights and the Constitution, where we have been given certain inalienable rights, such as life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Totally different from the French Revolution, the Communist Revolution, and all the humanistic revolutions. Because the fundamental difference is it is God that gives you the right for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, not man. See, the United Nations has its rights, but like all humanist revolutions, and like all humanist institutions which grant rights, they also reserve the right for themselves to take away your rights anytime they choose. So it's kind of like, well, today we're giving you the rights, but tomorrow we may change our mind. Those aren't real rights. And that's why humanistic revolutions always, without exception, fail. Now, the United States, it's God, or the Creator, capital C. It's recognized, it's God, the Creator, that gives us these rights. And we have these unique Bill of Rights, like freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of assembly, freedom of the press. But all these rights are under attack by people who embrace the socialist, humanist, Marxist, revolutionary viewpoint. And in the name of social justice, in the name of fairness, in the name of compassion, in the name of ending racism, in the name of all these virtuous callings, they are going to destroy our society and turn it into a totalitarian state. And you say, well, Paul, how do you know that? You know that because if you look at history, it's self-evident. If you insist upon living in a vacuum and insist upon denying the powerful truths that history teaches us, and the people who are involved in these movements know nothing of history, you will see that without exception, humanist, Marxist, social revolutions, which always promise social justice, by the way, always, end up as dictatorships where people lose their rights. And we don't want that to happen in the United States. We will be unable to continue to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ effectively if we allow that to happen. And that is why what is happening in the next number of months, weeks, years, especially this time period, 2016-2017, is a critical, we're at the most critical juncture in our nation's history. And America, continuing to be a platform for the preaching of the gospel, it's essential that we preserve this. Number two is we have to obey the words of Jesus Christ and be diligent. We must occupy until he comes. And if we refuse to obey the Lord, which is what much of the church in America has chosen to do, it has refused to obey the Lord. It lives in denial and disobedience. We will certainly lose our freedoms. We will lose our prosperity. And we will lose our privilege to preach the gospel and make disciples of all nations. So, what is our responsibility? Well, our responsibility is that we must, each one of us, obey the mission that God has called each one of us to. And it begins with the small things. So, at Paul McGuire Ministries in Paradise Mountain Church, this is the mission. that God has called me to teach Bible prophecy, to analyze current events, to explain current events in the light of Bible prophecy, and then equip and educate God's people biblically so that they can understand the dynamics of what's going on and fulfill their mission and accomplish what God called them to accomplish. That's why the books that I write, I've always written with the idea in mind that people would invite people over to their houses for coffee and to discuss them and to implement what they teach, or that they would be given to the youth group leader or to a pastor or the head of a Bible study or a prayer group, and they would study it and then act on it and pray on the principles, because they're action books. So whether it's the book Prophecy of the Future of America, the first one, or Mass Awakening, or the brand new book, A Prophecy of the Future of America 2016-2017, and the 4-DVD set of the same title, or books like Standing Down Goliath, or The Day the Dollar Died. These are books that are designed to get you up to speed really quickly and to supernaturally equip you in the end times to be victorious for Jesus Christ. And you can help spread this message by going to paulmcguire.us. And we have all kinds of apps you can use to encourage people to listen to the Paul McGuire Report, which airs 2 hours every day on Blog Talk Radio. And you can encourage people to download, use the various download apps, and listen to the show and the teaching contained in each show at times that are easy for them to listen to, and spread the word and spread the knowledge and spread the teaching so that we can make changes in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Knowledge is power. So if they go to paulmcguire.us, we have great discounts on the books and the DVDs and bundle packages, but also we have a whole list of apps where you can download the Paul McGuire Report however it is most convenient for you, by clicking the link for Blog Talk Radio or YouTube or SoundCloud or iTunes or Stitcher or Blueberry or RSS feed. And for those of you that want to contact us via the mail, our address is there. So together, if each one of us will respond to the Lord and fulfill the mission that God has called us to, we can bring in the gospel of Jesus Christ and we can make a difference. But if we insist upon being apathetic, which most of the church is insisting on being apathetic, what that means, we're going to suffer some pretty heavy prices. I mean, some pretty heavy things are going to come down. That verse should speak to all of us in 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and heal their land. So God starts out not pointing the finger to the non-believers, not pointing the finger to those that Christians would say are sinful people. God is pointing the finger at his people. See, we're the ones that are responsible for the mess that's going on. God says, if my people, who are called by my name, that's the church, that's Christians, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, and humble yourself means admit that you don't know all the answers, admit that you're teachable, admit that you've been wrong, admit that you're willing to change, admit that you're open to correction. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways, not pointing the finger at other people's wicked ways, the church and Christians turning from their wicked ways, these are the conditions, then the Lord has a promise. Then I will hear from heaven and heal their land. So it's It's a formula, if you will, that God is giving us. If my people, which are the people of God, Christians, the church, who are called by my name, will humble themselves, that means not being arrogant, that means not having an unteachable attitude, will humble themselves. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways and pray, then I will hear from heaven and heal their land. Now, the question has to be asked, and you know the answer. And by the way, you can get all these download apps at paulmcguire.us, as well as the countless free articles and YouTubes and all kinds of free stuff. And you can go into the archives and listen to previous programs. And we have pictures and a lot of interactive stuff with the articles that make them really interesting and fun to read. Like the latest article just is called Pokemon Go Politicians and Social Bot Elections. And it's an examination into augmented reality, the manipulation of elections with computers and algorithms, and social bots, which are social media robots, which pretend to be people. When you go into social media like Facebook and you think you're talking to a person, in reality, you're talking to a social bot that's programmed to act like a person, but is programmed to tear down a particular individual cause or whatever. And so it helps people to become aware of these technologies because they're very much at work. So, the question I want to ask you with, again, as a challenge is, in light of everything we've discussed, what is God calling you to do? What is the Holy Spirit calling you to do? What is your mission? And are you saying yes to the Lord when he calls you to fulfill your mission? And if you're not, then what's stopping you? What's hindering you? Because we want to help you at Paul McGuire Ministries. We want to help you understand that the Lord can supernaturally release you to accomplish the mission he's called you to before the beginning of time. In addition, at Paul McGuire Ministries, we want to encourage you again to spread the link of this program and the other materials to help release others. And as I talk to you, and as you think about the topic of today's program and other programs, I'm sure the Lord has brought people to your mind and given you a burden for people to pray for them. God has brought people to your mind who need to hear this message, who you know them, you know that they have talents and abilities and gifts, and God has a call in their life. It may not be a, quote, full-time call into the, quote, full-time ministry in the traditional sense, but we're all in the ministry. It doesn't mean we're in the traditional ministry. We may have jobs in any kind of field, and that can become a ministry. God doesn't have these little cookie cutter. He doesn't make us little cookie cutter cookies that are all like one another. We're each individual. So the Lord is probably bringing to your mind people that need to be released to fulfill their mission and their destiny. And you could help make that happen by sending them this message or sending them the link, but then telling them why you're sending them the link, not just send them a link and they look at it and go, what's this? And they don't utilize it. You got to communicate to them why they should hear it or why they should check it out or what's in it that could help them. So, many people, perhaps you sense that God's called you to do something. In fact, I've had, again, countless numbers of people come up to me and talk to me and tell me pretty precisely what they believe the Lord has called them to do or what the dream is that God has put in their heart. But then they explain to me that they're unable to accomplish it for whatever reason, and they're like stuck and they're frustrated because they have this incredible desire to do something or this sense of mission or this sense of they were gifted by God or called by God to do something. and they aren't doing it, and they're frustrated because of whatever it is that's blocking them from the release of their destiny. And I understand that. Believe me, I understand that, because my ministry did not happen overnight. My ministry took a long time, and I worked very hard and toiled in obscurity. And even though, you know, I've written 28 books and all the rest of that stuff, but despite the fact that I had a national presence, you know, decades ago, my ministry and calling did not was not easy. So I understand the spiritual battles involved in overcoming the blocks and the barriers to releasing your talents and abilities. And so let me just address that for a moment, because you're listening to me and ideas are playing through your mind regarding what your call or destiny is, but there are things that are blocking it. So I'm going to just talk for a moment about a couple of things that can potentially block the release of your destiny, talents, and ministry. But more importantly, I'm going to share briefly a spiritual principle or biblical principles that you can use to overcome those blockages and to break through those barriers that stand between you and the fulfillment in what God's called you to do. So let's start with the basic thing. The basic thing is, God has definitely equipped every one of his people with different callings and gifts and talents. Now, you have an enemy, the devil, demons, and your enemy wants to seek to discourage you, wants to tell you that you have no mission, you have no destiny, you have no gifts and talents, and he will use situations, he will use people, to speak negatively in your life, and he will especially use Christians and spiritual people or family members, those closest to you, to speak negatively in your life, so that with the desired objective of destroying the dream that God has put in you and bringing about such a level of discouragement that you feel it's hopeless and give up. And many of you listening to me right now, you know exactly what I'm talking about, because you're experiencing that emotional state of hopelessness, despair, fear, the sense of being overwhelmed, and you feel like there's no hope, and you've tried and tried and tried, and you feel like throwing in the towel and giving up. And one of the and behind a lot of this, not all of it, but behind a lot of it is there's a real devil with demons that instigate things in our lives and works through people to discourage us. And I'll give you an example. And I call it the principle of identity. And I deal with this principle of identity in A Prophecy of the Future of America 2016-2017. So your identity, which is who you really are, is partially developed by yourself and your imagination and your mind, and then a great deal of it is put into you by God. So let's say you believe that you have the talents and abilities to be an entrepreneur and create some kind of company where you're going to sell some kind of product and service, and you want to use that company to generate money, and you want to help finance ministries and evangelism, but you also want to make your company so dynamic and interesting that your company and the way you do business is a light for the gospel. You don't have to have a giant sign on the building that says Jesus saves, but your corporate culture, the way you do business, it's your dream that people will see, gee, there's a difference in the way you do things, in the way your company operates, and in your style of leadership, and it attracts people to Jesus Christ. And that's just one potential dream or idea a person has. And so you develop it in your mind, you observe other companies, you make comparisons, and you probably don't fully realize that the spirit of a man is the candle of the Lord. That's a Bible verse. The spirit of a man is a candle of the Lord. So what you think, what you may think is you're just your human imagination and your human spirit producing ideas and beliefs and a vision about the development of this company, product, or service is not just you thinking out of your human spirit. Your human spirit, without you fully being aware of it, is being illuminated by the Holy Spirit. In fact, it's like God is projecting a movie of what he wants for your life, but he's projecting it on the screen of your own human spirit, your own human imagination. So you think that these ideas are yours, and they are yours, but you don't fully understand the degree by which it's God that is illuminating through the light of his Holy Spirit your spirit, so that your ideas, which you think are just your ideas and plans, are more than that. Deep, deep down on a different level, they're actually being created and illuminated by the Lord himself. See? So it's not just like you had a good idea. It's God that gave you the idea. God is the giver of these ideas that we have, or these plans that we have. And so the spirit of a man is a candle of the Lord, which means your human spirit is being used by God like a candle to light up your inner being with dreams and visions and ideas in whatever venture you wish to pursue. And that's a good thing. So then, you know, you develop your talents and abilities, hopefully. You discover what you need to launch your enterprise or business or whatever. And you, let's say you share your dream with somebody. It could be a Christian. It could be somebody at church. It could be a loved one. It could be a family member. It could be a husband, wife, whoever. And they shoot it down when you share it. And they basically say, you know, you can't do that, or it's impossible, or you're not any good at that, or, you know, you should think of something else. And this is not just some lame idea you have. It's something that you really believe the Lord put in your heart and mind. So you have to be careful, because even husbands and wives, when they're not being careful, can make the mistake of shooting down that dream or idea that was given to you by God. Now, if it's been truly given to you by God, you have to walk around with the full armor of God on. I know this sounds somewhat paranoid, but I discovered in my own personal life that the most important place that I should put on the full armor of God is not just out there in the external battlefield. It's in the environment of a church, or being around Christians, or even being around family members. Why? Because the greatest vulnerability that I would have to spiritual attacks, like somebody trying to snuff out a dream or you know, disempower your idea, would come in environments where you let your guard down because you think that it's safe. So I discovered that putting on the full armor of God, gird your loins about with truth, shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, put on the breastplate of righteousness, pick up the shield of faith, where which we shall quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Put on the helmet of salvation. Pick up the sword of the Spirit, and render the principalities and powers harmless and ineffective against us in the name of Jesus. Well, I realized that the full armor of God needed to be put on, especially the shield of faith, to block the fiery darts of the wicked. What are the fiery darts of the wicked? It's the statements, the phrases, the words that somebody could speak at us And if we drop our shield, they can penetrate our heart with negativity, disillusionment, unbelief, and really wound us, if we're not careful, into allowing an idea which goes against God, like, you're not qualified, or you're not intelligent enough, or you can never accomplish this, or you need to give that up. And it's something through trial and error you have studied and you've tested and you're convinced. It's not that you shouldn't seek a multitude of counselors. You should, but you still have to be careful. If you're absolutely convinced that something is of God, and assuming that you've developed your maturity in Christ, so you're not just being led by a whimsical imagination and flights of fancy, because that's another danger. I meet a lot of people who, you know, absolutely convinced that God called them to be a movie star for Christ. And I hear that all the time, and they're dead serious. And I'm not saying some people are not called to be movie stars for Christ, but a lot of the people who say that are not. And that's not suggesting that there are some that are not, that there are some that are called to do that, but many are not, or whatever the field is. So I'm assuming that you've paid the price to develop yourself spiritually, and that you can discern the spirits. So you don't just allow your dream to be destroyed when it simply may be demonic powers or Satan using the person who's being used by demonic powers to destroy your dream. May very possibly not even be aware that they're being used. May just be speaking ignorantly. But you've got to guard yourself against that and protect your dream and not give it up just because it's a challenge. And that's very important, because people will come into our lives, especially when we're vulnerable. And if you have a call from God, and it really is from God, you can't allow somebody just to casually shoot it down. So that's one thing. You've got to protect your dream. You've got to protect the idea that God has called you to do. You can't just give it up just because of its challenge. Then another thing is that you have to take the baby steps of obedience to make that dream happen. A lot of people, you know, they have a call from God, an idea from God, or a plan from God, and then they sit around waiting for God to drop into their laps, and it doesn't work that way. You have to begin, you know, like inch by inch, baby step by baby step, doing the small things, the taking care of the details, learning and growing step by step to begin building your dream. In other words, you have to start walking out on faith to develop it. And you may have to do that for a long time. When I say long time, I'm talking about decades. I'm talking to people who are serious about seeing their dreams happen. Because if you're not ready to pay the price, you know, a lot of dreams, most dreams come through much effort. They come through hard work, and they come through faithfulness, and they come through, you know, I'll give you a case in point. And you'll hear this from many authors. My first book, I submitted to, 30-something Christian publishers. It was around that number. That's not probably a 100% accurate number, but it was around that number. So let's just say 30 Christian publishers. Of which, all of them turned me down. And then, you know, you don't even get a rejection letter most of the time. Just no response, or you get a, you know, it's not a person. It's just a rejection letter. So do you give up? Say, okay, I'm not a writer. I'm not called to write books because you get 30 rejection letters. No, because I don't know how long after that. I guess it was the 30th person I contacted just happened to be a young editor who really related to the content of my manuscript, which was about my testimony of God delivering me from the New Age movement, and because we were both young and shared similar experiences, he was like really, really high on the book, excited about it because it was like contemporary, and it was a book that personally excited him. So we're off and running with the first book. And then, but if I allowed the third, but there have been times, one particular publisher, this was early on in my writing career, I had an in with this publisher because a friend of mine was one of the best-selling authors with this particular publishing company. So I was able to use his name at least to get an in. And I sent them my proposal and, you know, proposed manuscript. And I got the manuscript returned, but they accidentally sent to me a private in-house memo between the two heads of the company where the person that was responsible for evaluating my manuscript was communicating to somebody else internally. I wasn't supposed to see this memo. And essentially, the memo ripped me to shreds. I mean, totally ripped me to shreds. With a lot of curse words and sarcasm and whole thing. So being young and inexperienced at that time, I was annoyed. And so I called up the publisher and I took him to task. It wasn't like everything he said was completely falsehood. There were truths in what he said. But, you know, I think I'd only published one or two books by that time. So it was a pretty brutal critique and unfair. So anyway, they got very indignant that I dared to challenge them. But then they demanded legally, which they had no right to demand, that I return the memo. Because what they were really, they didn't care. They could care less that they insulted me and whatever. That meant nothing to them. What they were terrified was that I would share the internal memo to other people, including the person who had the in with the publishing company. They were terrified that I would circulate that memo because it would reveal the way they really operated and what they really thought about not just me, but a lot of authors. So if I had allowed that, and it must have been painful looking back in retrospect, or I wouldn't have called the publisher, but if I had, and it was ruthless, and if I had allowed that critique to destroy my writing ministry, then I would have made a fatal mistake, because there the devil is using a human personality. Who knows? The guy may be the guy. You know, a lot of times you deal with people who are frustrated in their own fields, and they take it out on you. So the point is, though, that it was pretty rough, and if I had, it turned out that one of his main critical points ended up being my primary strength as a writer. The thing he criticized me most for, the number one thing he criticized me for, turned out to be my primary gift and primary strength as a writer. But if I accepted his analysis of it being a negative, I would have thrown in the towel. As time went on, what he'd thought was a negative turned out to be the reason why people bought my books and why I was able to do rather well in the publishing industry. So we can't allow other people to determine our identity. And whether, you know, we're good at something, it doesn't mean we don't have to be open to correction or whatever, but you just can't open the floodgates and allow anybody to come in and crush your dream. You've got to protect it and you've got to guard it. And if God has told you to do something, then you do it. In the same way, a lot of people have false beliefs about themselves. that come from sinful men and women who yield themselves to a demonic spirit and say things to them, like they're told when they're a young child by their father or mother. They're told that they're stupid or they won't amount to anything. Or somebody of power and influence, maybe a teacher or a parent, tells you when you're young and vulnerable that you're dumb and not all that bright or stupid or not intelligent or you'll never amount to anything. Or essentially puts a curse on your life and says, oh, your life will never mean anything. And because you're so young and vulnerable, that becomes like this programming that just locks you up. And many people then live out this curse that's spoken over them. And they don't become anything because they believe the lie that was spoken to them, spoken over them. And Satan is the father of lies. Now, I happen to believe that the reason that sometimes happens is because the devil knows that you do have a destiny in God. So he's trying to destroy it before it manifests. So he uses somebody to essentially curse your life. And there's a supernatural component to that, by the way, in terms of generational curses and in terms of what brothers and sisters say to each other and so on and so forth. I was working in a particular job environment many years ago. And I had a secret fear that I would never be able to accomplish certain things for various reasons. And it was a secret fear. I mean, I didn't share it with a whole lot of people, but it tormented me. It was a real fear. And the devil would agitate it, you know. And I had a person walk up to me out of the blue, knew nothing about me, walked up to me with his one young son, pointed his finger at me, looked at me, and said, it was the most demonic thing, one of the most demonic things I ever experienced. And he basically pointed at me and said, out of the blue, I never met this guy, and said that I would never accomplish certain things. I mean, how did he even know what my goals were? For such and such a reason. And it played into, the point is that what the words he used literally locked into my deepest fears. And it was demonic. Because these kinds of things don't happen. People just don't walk up to you out of the middle of nowhere and speak stuff into your life as if they know you and then essentially put you a curse on you. I mean, he never came out and, you know, quote, cursed me. But the net effect of his words were to curse me and restrict me. And so it was so eerie and chilling that I was awakened to the fact that there's a supernatural element to a lot of this. There was no way on earth that this guy could have just came into my life and said what he said. He literally, whether he was aware of it or not, was sent there by a demonic spirit. And that demonic spirit was trying to destroy me. Now, I had to fight spiritually by renewing my mind. I had to really train my mind. And that's what I want to share with you. Ultimately, who you are is who God says you are. And what you can be is what God says you can be. And you have to, if you're tempted to criticize yourself and say to yourself negative things, after God has said certain things, let's say positively about who you are and who you can be, or somebody you respect or love says negative things about who you are or what you can be, you have to make the willful decision to reject the negative statements by yourself or other people as lies, and you have to make the willful decision to believe God's assessment about you above anybody else's, including yourself. Because in the final analysis, it doesn't matter what this person says about you or that person says about you. The only thing that matters is what God says about you. and what God says you can do and what God says you're called to do. See, that's the only thing that matters, because he's the king of the universe. He's God Almighty. He's the only one who knows everything. So when it comes to analyzing yourself, whether or not you're intelligent, if God has called you to do something, he's also given you the intelligence and wisdom to do it. So ultimately, you have to believe the spiritual battle of the mind is centered in the fact that you have to believe God and his promises and what God says about you over whatever else is coming into your life. And that's how you win the spiritual battlefield. If God has called you to do something, then you have to fight the good fight of faith. You have to believe that it can be done. And many times when we're called to do something, you know, I'm talking to a lot of people right now, and your minds are all engaged in what I'm saying, and you're applying it to your own life. But this is a principle. God calls you to do something. He's given you a dream or a vision. You may have even begun doing it, but then you get trapped in spiritual battles. Things come up to try to derail you. Opponents come into your life. Resistance happens. Problems happen into your life. All kinds of weird things happen in your life, trying to rob you of energy, to rob you of money, to rob you of the willpower to keep on track with what God has called you to do. That's part of what happens. When you have a call or a dream or a vision from God, there's a spiritual battle that unfolds as you try to possess your promised land. Because when God calls you to do something or gives you a dream or a vision or a call or an idea, it's very much similar to God calling his people to possess the promised land. Because you, in effect, are being called by God to possess a promised land. But it may not be a geographic land. It may be the land of an idea, a dream, a business, a ministry, a creative thing. Who knows what it is? It may not be a geographic land, but it's a land of something that you have to possess. And in order to possess it, you're going to have to fight the giants or the enemies that are in the land. Now, they may not be the same enemies as the Nephilim giants in Canaan, but they may be people, they may be attitudes, they may be financial problems, they may be sicknesses, they may be fatigue things, illnesses, all kinds of things you have to fight. Problems in your marriage, your home, with your children, all kinds of things can erupt. And so, like Joshua and Caleb, the only way to take the land is to make a decision with your will that you are going to fight the good fight of faith, and you're going to believe God for the impossible, and you're going to say to God, we are well able to take the land. Because if God has called you to something, he has also given you the power to do it. But you have to believe that. And there's going to be a fight. The devil's going to tell you, no, you don't have the power to do it. And so you have to fight for your promised land, and there will be giants. And the giants may be fatigued. The giants may be poverty. The giants may be conflicts in relationship or balancing two jobs or three jobs or whatever it is. So you fight the good fight of faith, and you'll always end up in this place. You will discover, and this is by God's intention, you will discover that if you are trying to fulfill God's plan, vision, dream, or destiny for your life in your own strength, even if you don't think you're doing that, God will bring you to a place where you simply run out of your own strength or resources or money or time or energy or whatever. You just won't have enough of what you need. You will come to that place, and then you will be tempted to despair and say, I'm not going to be able to do this. I don't have the strength, the energy, the wisdom, or whatever. You will be tempted to embrace a false belief that it is impossible for you to do what God has called you to do, which is a lie of the devil. But really, God is allowing you to come to the end of yourself, and if you'll really lay hold of God at that moment, it will be your greatest breakthrough. Because what God is trying to do is transition you from relying on your own strength and ability and resources to recognizing that ultimately, in order for you to accomplish what God has called you to accomplish, you are going to have to rely on God's supernatural resources, His supernatural strength, His supernatural wisdom, His supernatural energy, His supernatural supply, and that you can have victory, but only to the degree that through faith you appropriate the promises of God and tap into, through faith, God's supernatural resources. Now, that's it. That's what everybody that's used by God has to come to this place. That's what David, I mean, King David, when he had to battle Goliath, remember, all the warriors of Israel had the physical, supposedly had the physical energy, strength, and warfare skills to defeat Goliath. But they couldn't. Goliath was too powerful for them to defeat on their own strength, ability, and resources. So they cowered in fear along with King Saul, who was relying on the armor of the flesh or the armor of his own resources, human resources. But David entered into the spiritual battle against Goliath, but his approach was different. He didn't rely on his own strength, his own flesh, his own resources. He relied on the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and the anointing of the Holy Spirit gave him a supernatural plan to conquer the giant Goliath and have victory. And that anointing of the Holy Spirit was supernatural. It was something outside of himself that David possessed by faith. And when he walked in that anointing, he was guided by the Lord to use his slingshot. And with one stone, he dropped Goliath, and the battle was turned. Now, why did David succeed when all the mighty men of Israel failed? For one reason, David was not relying on his own strength, wisdom, intelligence, and abilities as the source of his victory and the source of his power. David was relying on God's supernatural resources, strength, and power, and ability. And to the degree that David put his faith in God's supernatural power, faith, and ability, that was to the degree that he was victorious. And every single one of you listening to me, including myself, any man or woman that chooses to be used by God or engages in any spiritual battle, we all, God allows all of us, sooner or later, to come to this place, sometimes once, sometimes many places, where you've been battling something, and as far as you think in your mind, because we see through a glass darkly, you think you're doing it God's way. I've made this mistake myself many times. I think I'm doing it God's way. And you're convinced that you're relying on the Lord, and then you become frustrated, and you become discouraged because you don't see the victory. But then the Lord brings you to the place where the light of the Holy Spirit brings revelation to you, as he's doing now. The light of the Holy Spirit is bringing revelation to you right now and showing you that the reason that you have not succeeded and the reason that you have not accomplished what he has called you to do is that you have been, perhaps without you fully realizing it, you have been relying on your own strength, energy, and resources. And God is trying to teach you that you can't have the total victory. You can't do what he's calling you to do on your own strength. The only way you're going to have victory is to rely on his supernatural power, his supernatural wisdom, and his supernatural strength, and you possess that by faith. And when you do that, when you make that transition, when you make that change, all of a sudden, you will see the Red Sea part. All of a sudden, you'll experience the resurrection. All of a sudden, Goliath will drop in front of you. All of a sudden, you will have victory when before you had no victory. As it says in the Word, The Christian life is from faith to faith. God is using these trials and tribulations to purify your faith, to make it like gold. Now, what I shared, I believe many of you received. And God is going to give you victory and use you greatly as you appropriate this powerful truth, because it will transform your life. And this powerful truth can change the destiny of a nation like America. It can change any person listening to me, no matter what nation you live in. You can change the destiny of that nation by applying this supernatural principle. This is the key for unlocking God's supernatural power. It's the key to revival. It's the key to a biblical great awakening. It's a key to societal change. It's the key to releasing the power inherent in every Christian in the church. It's the key to walking in victory. And it's the key to walking in a supernatural relationship with God, where you learn how to think supernaturally and act supernaturally. Now, I know that the message that I just shared with you has set many of you free, because I can feel the power of God filling this studio right now. I feel the anointing of the Lord and the presence of the Lord, and the anointing breaks the yoke, and yokes have been broken through the power of the Holy Spirit. And you, if you will listen to the Lord may be saying to you, you know, bringing people to your mind who need to hear this message. Well, share it with them. Share the truth that sets people free with other people. And you can go do that by going to paulmcguire.us and downloading this message and sending it to your friends, wherever they are, through all kinds of social media apps that we have for you, iTunes, YouTube, Blog Talk Radio. And spread the word. God bless you. I'm Paul McGuire, and I will join you on the next edition of the Paul McGuire Report. Remember, visit paulmcguire.us for archives and all kinds of free information. God bless you, and remember, Jesus is Lord, and all things are possible with God.